Today I will still focus on topological dynamics, and François will speak in the last two lectures about ergodic theory and measures. Okay, so today I will focus on infinite volume situation. So gamma is a subgroup of SO D1, let's say D equals 3. It's a discrete and Zariski dance. And as I said, it's not a lattice, and maybe some people needed some examples. So most classical example is when gamma is a Schottky group. So you take finitely many loxodromic isometries with one repulsive and one attractive point. And if you are lucky enough, it will generate a discrete Zariski dense subgroup. Another example, which is far from being a lattice, is that if gamma is a normal subgroup of some co-compact lattice, and if the covering group is infinite, then your gamma will not be a lattice at all. I'm not able to do three-dimensional pictures, but in dimension two, you can imagine infinitely generated surfaces. What other examples? I would like to indicate you an interesting result, an interesting example of Marc Peignet. The title of the paper should be something like Exotic Schottky Group, I don't remember exactly, where he gives an example in dimension 4 of a discrete group which is geometrically infinite and still with finite measure of maximal entropy. I will not focus on this example today. Okay, so anyway, there are many examples of discrete Zariski dense subgroups of SOD1 which are not lattices. Okay, and yesterday I mentioned Ratner's result. In fact, Ratner theorems do not use really the assumption that gamma is a lattice. And her results apply here in this situation, but what does it say? It says that, okay, it still classifies U or N invariant probability measures. The point is that in this situation, the naturally interesting N or U invariant measures will not be a probability measure, they will be infinite. So
a normal subgroup of a co-compact lattice is always generates.
It generates a cover.
How do you know that it will be of infinite volume?
If the covering group is not finite.
Okay, so but this you can pose.
Yes, I said it, but I didn't write it. Thank you. Okay, so Ratner does not help us to understand the interesting dynamics. So we have to do something else. Okay, first, today I will introduce some notations and then state our results correctly, because as François noticed yesterday, my statements yesterday were not completely exact. If you want, anyway, if you want precise statements, I learned that our paper is should be in archive today, so.
Huh?
It was not yesterday, but today it is. Okay, so gamma acts on HD, and so it acts also on the boundary. And okay, if here it's the picture of the hyperbolic ball of dimension 3. If you look at any point, let's say O is the origin of the ball, it's the center of the ball, and you can look at an orbit of the orbit of O, and the limit set is defined as the closure of any orbit in the boundary. Okay, and that's the important set in the boundary. And okay, what can be the limit set? Maybe it's important. We'll notice that if when gamma is a lattice, the limit set is equal to the full boundary. So when studying lattices, one does not speak about limit sets, because. What else? If gamma, in the case where gamma is not Zariski dense, for example, if gamma is a subgroup of SL2R inside PSL2C, then, or a conjugate of PSL2R, you will have the limit set will be inside a circle, inside the sphere. That are, these two examples do not interest us, but it's just to understand. The typical picture that I will draw for a limit set, I think to it as a counter set, even if it's not always a counter set. And okay, it will be something like that. That will be the picture of my limit set inside the boundary. And okay, I will not need it today, but an important notion is the notion of critical exponent, which helps studying this limit set. What is a critical exponent? It can be defined in several ways. Okay, it's the critical exponent of the series this series converges for S large and diverges for S small, and so there is a critical exponent which is called delta gamma. This critical exponent is also the growth rate of an orbit. The group gamma is discrete, so maybe I will do another picture. If you look, it's the picture of the hyperbolic ball. If you look at an orbit and the number of points inside a ball of radius r, this number is finite. But it grows exponentially fast, and the exponential growth rate is exactly this critical exponent. So it's this growth rate. It also equals the topological entropy of the geodesic flow. In fact, all these equalities are theorems, or that's due to Othal-Peigné in full generality. And it's also the Hausdorff dimension, not of the full limit set, but of what is called the radial limit set, which is, I don't want to define it now, but somehow it's the recurrent part in some sense. And so that's the critical exponents that appeared yesterday in the ergodic theory statements. Okay. So, but it does not appear in the topological dynamics statement of today. So, okay, François will speak about it more in details tomorrow. Now, okay, this limit set is an important set for studying the dynamics. And in fact, we have to restrict our study to frames whose directions are inside the limit set. So, as I said yesterday, the group G identifies with the set of orthonormal frames of H3. But the good frames will be those who point forward and backward inside the limit set. Okay, so I will consider the set omega tilde, which is a set of frames such that, recall from yesterday that in the Hopf coordinates, the frame of H3 identifies with frames of the boundary times the boundary minus the diagonal times R. That's the coordinate that I introduced yesterday. To a frame X, I associate a frame X plus on the boundary, a point X minus on the boundary, and a real parameter. And, okay, I will be interested in the set omega tilde, which is a set of frames such that x plus is a frame above the limit set, and x minus is a point of the limit set. And of course, as I am studying dynamics in G mod gamma, we will study the dynamics of A on the set omega, which is omega tilde mod gamma. And there is an old result of Eberlein, which lifts from the unit tangent bundle to the frame bundle, which says that this omega is a non-wandering set. Of the R action. X plus is what? As I said yesterday, X plus is a frame on the boundary. And as I said also yesterday, I draw only I forget the last vector of the frame, so a frame on a sphere S2 is determined by the first vector, and it's a frame whose point is in the limit set. It's a frame, so it's a point in a direction. In the point, I just ask that the point is in the limit set, and the vector is what I want. It's the only requirement is that the point is in the limit set. And the direction is whatever you want. I will not define what is a non-wandering set. If you don't know what is a non-wandering set, just think that it's an interesting set to study the dynamics of a dynamical system. What did I want to say? Okay. The point in the infinite volume situation is, okay, as I showed you yesterday, the dynamics of A and N are strongly related. And so you deduce properties on N actions by understanding the A action. But if you look at this set, and if you remind what is the N action? Okay, maybe still a picture. So my limit set is like that. Take some geodesic pointing forward and backward in the limit set and some frame on this geodesic. And then what is the n orbit of this frame? It's a set of frames which are based on this sphere and parallel in some sense to this x in the model of the upper half plane and pointing towards the same point. So it's easy to see that beginning with a frame x which is in my set omega, I can find in its n orbit some xn or xu which is not pointing backward inside the limit set. As soon as the limit set is not everything, I will find a point in the n orbit of x which is not in omega. So, and there is no hope for something else. So omega is not an invariant. And so it's natural to consider the set of n orbits intersecting omega. And this set, well, you can also define E tilde, which is the set of n orbit of omega tilde. And this is an invariant set, and this is a natural set to study the dynamics of N and U. Okay, so. What? E? E? No? It's okay? Ah, the button. Sorry.
You claim that omega is an unwanted set of A action. Is it like an, you define omega to be omega tilde mod gamma?
Yes.
And so is it easy to see that it's an unwanted set or?
It's a theorem of Eberlein. It's a theorem of Eberlein at the level of the unit tangent bundle, but as you are looking at a compact extension of the unit tangent bundle, it's okay.
Is it difficult here?
I don't remember. I mean, okay, it's old, so it's not so difficult, but at this time, it's not a trivial result. But I don't, okay. The honest answer is really, I don't remember. Of the A action, no. In fact, I will do a picture in dimension 2, even if our results are not interesting in dimension 2, just to do a picture. If you, a typical example of an infinite volume surface is something like that. A compact part and a funnel, and then omega is a set of geodesic which stay in the compact part which never cross this periodic orbit, and then the set E is a set of Hohr cycles which have some vector in the Hohr cycle which is here in this part, but you can have a for example, you can imagine a periodic orbit here with some vector v here, which is in omega, and then it has a Hohr cycle, which which will typically go everywhere. And then on this row cycle, you will find some W, which is in E, but not in omega. So that's the picture in dimension two, but in dimension, in higher dimension, the same phenomenon up here.
It's a stable manifold.
What?
It's a stable manifold.
Yes, yes.
Isn't it the non-wandering set of the inaction?
It will be, yes. Yes. Okay, the point, okay, that's for the n-action, it's a natural set to study, and the point is also, that's a little bit the beginning of our study, is that this set is also the natural set for the u-action, which is not clear from the definition. The proposition that we proved, and that I will try to prove today, is that this set E is also, it's not exactly the set of u-orbit intersecting omega, but it's the closure of this set. And that's okay.
Does omega have anything to do with the convex form?
Omega, if you want, okay. The convex core is a, okay. It's almost the same, but omega is at the level of the unit tangent bundle or the frame bundle, and the convex core is a geometric notion on the manifold.
But do they project?
I guess that if you project omega on the manifold, then you have to take the convex hull. Yeah, maybe. Okay. Because the convex core is the convex hull of the limit set in the manifold, mod gamma. So it's a set of points. And as you took a convex hull, omega has, if you project omega on the manifold, you leave holes. But, okay, intuitively it's almost the same, but it's not exactly the same, okay? First, omega is at the level of the unit tangent bundle or the frame bundle, and the convex core is inside the manifold. But for example, they are compact or non-compact together, which is...
Just to be clear, the assumption on U is that it's just a subgroup of N that looks like R to the something.
Yes, and for all the talks, we will assume that we are in SO3-1, and N is isomorphic to R2, and I will take U to be isomorphic. As I said yesterday, in the model of the upper half space, I will take U to be this one. In PSL2C, it will be the set of such matrices, but just for the talk, it could be any unipotent group. Okay, this proposition, okay, is very okay. It's a key ingredient to understand that you have hope to get results for unipotent actions, even if. The set E is a priori defined to study the N action. Just to show that it's not trivial a priori. It can happen if I have a limit set like that. I can find N orbits like that where you have some frames here, for example, this one is in omega, and you can find on this N orbit a full U orbit which do not intersect this set. So these, let's say that this y frame Y is such that YU does not intersect omega. But still, what says this proposition is that, okay, it's in the closure, mod gamma. Okay. Before to understand the topological dynamics on the frame bundle, I will recall what is known and what is useful to know at the level of the unit tangent bundle. H3 or HD. And okay, when gamma has infinite covolume, but it's also true for lattices. Okay. The following theorem is true. And okay. So I will describe three properties which are equivalent and which are satisfied for geodesic flows on hyperbolic manifolds. So how to state that? The following properties are equivalent and true. No. This will maybe be more convincing and true in constant. It's more convincing like that. So the first property is that the geodesic flow is topologically mixing. I think I didn't give the definition yesterday, I will give it. The length spectrum, I will give the definition, is non-arithmetic. Is topology mixing on omega. In fact, I cheat a little bit because I defined omega at the level of frame bundle, but okay, it's the omega of the unit tangent bundle. What I called yesterday P1 of omega. And there exists a vector on the unit tangent bundle such that its strong stable leaf is dense in. And in fact, one can prove that it's true for V periodic for the geodesic flow. This theorem is the last version is due to Françoise Dalbeau, but some parts of it were due to Edlund or Eberlein. Maybe if you have other names to add to this. So the last version with full references is due to Françoise Dalbeau. And for some parts, some implications are due to Edlund and Eberlein. Okay. So in constant negative curvature, this statement is true. Okay? So maybe some definition to explain this theorem. So topologically mixing, what does it mean? It means that for any two open sets, O1 and O2, there exists some T naught, such that for all T larger than T naught, the orbit I didn't give a notation for the geodesic flow on the unit tangent bundle. Maybe the geodesic flow will be GT. Then for all T large enough, the orbit of G1 of O1 will intersect O2. What does mean the non-arithmeticity of the length spectrum? Non-arithmeticity. It means that if you look at the group generated by the length of all the periodic orbits of the geodesic flow. You look at the subgroup of air generated by all these lengths, it's dense. In air. And the last property, it's just that the strong stable manifold of the geodesic flow. Maybe I didn't define what is a strong stable manifold. The strong stable manifold of a vector V is a set of vectors W such that asymptotically in the future they have, it's a set of vector W which have the same future as V. Before studying the U action on the frame bundle, we need to understand the N action in the frame bundle. And to understand the N action in the frame bundle, in fact, we will need such properties. And so we will need to lift these properties at the level of the frame bundle. But how can you prove things on the dynamics of the geodesic flow usually? There is not a unique way, but the canonical way is to understand the properties through the action of the group gamma on the boundary. And so you understand, you have to understand the action of gamma on the boundary. Yes.
Is here the fact that it's true for the curvature case was
Francois proved that the in fact she enlightened the fact that all these properties are equivalent, because I think that before her people wanted to obtain some results, but the equivalence between non-arithmeticity and mixing, or non-arithmeticity and...
If you're just interested in constant curvature, then all these
were known? I don't remember exactly. Okay, so the action of gamma, we have to understand the action of gamma on the boundary. And, recall first that G mod gamma, as said yesterday, is a fiber bundle over T1 of H3 mod gamma. And the fiber is a circle, okay? The set of vectors, of frames having the same first vector is a circle. Okay, and recall also this classical fact. The action of gamma on its limit set is minimal. Okay, but now we want to lift these properties at the level of the frame bundle. Okay, the Hopf coordinates that I introduced yesterday, given a frame, we look in the past at a point in the limit set and in the future at a frame in the limit set. Okay? So we need this result, which is that the action of gamma on the set of frames based on the limit set is minimal. In fact, this theorem is due to Damien Fert in the case D equal 3. And it's a student of François Zalbaud, and it was 2002, something like that. And in any dimension, and there is a more general version due to Givarch-Rogy, in 2007. And in fact, we will need more than this theorem. And we will need something which is given by the Givarch-Rogge theorem. What is the Givarch-Rogge theorem? They don't consider only this extension of the limit set. They consider any compact extension of the limit set. And so let me introduce. Okay, I will state it in our particular case, but their theorem is more general and it's valid in higher rank. Okay, but here I state it for SO3-1 or SOD1. I will consider, okay, maybe first, before stating the theorem, as a remark, G in the Iwasawa decomposition of G is KAN. K-A-N, and M is a group of rotation commuting with A, and the boundary can be identified to G mod M-A-N, okay? If you take a point in the boundary, the set of frames pointing precisely to the to this point it's exactly a MAN orbit of a given frame. Okay, so the boundary is identified to G mod MAN. And so we will consider a compact extension of this quotient G mod MAN. And so, okay, consider C a compact connected group and a representation from MAN to C, and the set X rho, which is G times C, quotiented by the equivalence relation.
What are you trying to do right now?
To state the Givarch-Rogge theorem. Givarch-Rogge.
It's more general than what you...
It's more general, and we will need a more general version than this one. For the moment, there is no gamma, but okay. Okay. Once again, Givarch-Rogge theorem is more general than that, but okay, I state what I need. So define X rho, which is G times C modulo the equivalence relation, which is that GC is equivalent to GMAN. Where is the minus one? Okay. Rho of MA. Minus one? C. Okay. I'm not sure about the minus one, but okay, we don't care. And then, okay. G acts on X rho just by multiplication on the first coordinate. Okay? For the moment, there is no result. And what is the result? Of course, this set is an extension, a compact extension of the boundary. And so there is a projection on the boundary, and I will call it P rho, P rho. And the result is that gamma acts minimally, minimally on the preimage of the limit set. So pi rho minus one of the limit set. That's a key theorem, a very hard one, and very useful. And that's exactly what will help us to get mixing. So how can we use it? Just, okay, for the group, just example where we will use it, if C equals M, it's a compact connected group, it's a rotation group, and then you will retrieve Fert result, Fert result. And then the representation from MAN to M is just what you mean. MAN is sent to M. And then?
Sorry, what's the row in the theorem?
A representation.
Okay.
Yeah, the morphism. A second useful example is when C is equal to MA, so A is not compact, of course, so you quotient A by something, by some element, let's say A0. And that is a compact connected group, and you can consider the map from MAN to C, which to MAN associate the class of MA mod A0. And these are the main examples that we will use.
And the generality of the original Givenchy LG is for all simple Lie groups?
Semi-simple algebraic Lie groups, so higher rank, and C does not need to be connected. Compact, yes, but not necessarily connected, and then they describe the connected component of the action of gamma, of the closures of orbits of the action of gamma on the. But we don't need such a generality. And then I will come back to, okay, the time is going too fast. I will come back to our result stated more correctly than yesterday. So first, we prove that our results in topological dynamics, if you consider a frame whose first vector is periodic for the geodesic flow, then its n orbit is dense.
Are you seeing that rho is surjective?
Again?
If you take rho to be the
identity, C has to be compact, so it cannot be the identity. A is not compact and N is not compact.
No, trivial representation, trivial morphism. Just rho sends everything to the identity.
Then X rho is the boundary?
No, it's surjective.
Quoi?
You have to add rho surjective. You want to be able to say C.
Thank you. Okay, if not, you can add what you want, which is not relevant to your group C. And okay, so the first point is that if you consider a frame which is periodic for the geodesic flow, then its n orbit is dense. From this, we deduce that the air action on omega is topologically mixing. The third result I already stated it, is that the closure of the u orbits intersecting omega is exactly the set of n orbits intersecting omega, that is the set E. And the fourth result, which is what I stated yesterday, is that the action of U on the set E is topologically transitive. I gave the definition yesterday, and maybe I will emphasize that it is equivalent to the existence of a dense orbit. Okay, so time is going faster than I want, but I will try to prove some of these results. And now, I didn't. Okay. I will try to. And one cannot do it two blackboards at the same time. Next time. Okay, I will try to prove the most that I can in these results, because there is a strong analogy in the proofs of the topological dynamics results that I proved today and the ergodic results that François will try to prove in the next lectures. Of course, in ergodic theory, there are more difficulties, but there is a philosophy which is similar. So, okay. So let me prove first that if I take a periodic vector, any frame over this vector has a dense n-orbit. Okay. First, what does it mean to be periodic? Okay, that's a closed geodesic. But at the level of a frame, if I look at a frame here over a periodic vector, it's not necessarily periodic, because in dimension higher than 2, you have loxodromic element. So after one period, the frame can be turned. Modulo gamma, what does it mean? It means that if I translate x by an element a naught, I will try to the x, it's almost equal to x, but modulo some rotation. I will write it here. Okay, after a period, I turned from m. Okay, that's the first point. The second remark is that I will use that I know what I know on the unit. What?
Is v equal to?
V is the first vector of x. V is this one, and x is the frame. The fact that is written here is that when I have a periodic vector for the geodesic flow at the level of the unit tangent bundle, the stable manifold is dense. Is dense in what? In the projection of the set E inside the unit tangent bundle. So if I lift this property, what do I get? So I get that the lift of the strong stable manifold of the vector V is not only the n orbit of X, but of also all frames in the fibers. So it gives me that XMN is dense in E. But I want to prove that XN is dense in E. So the only thing I need is to prove, we have to prove that the full fiber XM is inside the closure. Okay, and that will be given by the Givache-Rogge theorem. So how do we apply it? Okay, okay. So I have these elements A naught and M naught, and I will look at the group MA modulo the element A0, M0. And the morphism rho will be what you imagine. To MAN, I associate the equivalence class of MA in this group. Okay? And gamma, the action of gamma on the limit set, the lift of the limit set inside X rho is minimal. So it means, in particular, that there exists some sequence gamma k such that I will denote by brackets the equivalence class of something in X row. Where is the theorem of Guillaume? Okay, the equivalence class of GC will be denoted by with brackets. So there exists gamma k such that gamma k of XC of XE converges to XME. Oops. Can write it like that. There exists a sequence such that gamma k of this thing converges. What does it mean in the definition of X row? It means exactly that first, gamma k, there exists some mk, ak, nk, such that gamma k x mk ak nk converges to xm. But in the second coordinates, what does it mean? It means that inside the group C, the image of mk, ak, mk, ak, nk converges to the identity of C. So it means exactly that mk, ak is essentially equals to a naught, m0 naught, to some power j. And then I will cheat a little bit to finish faster, but one can do it without cheating. Then it gives me that gamma k x, this thing is essentially this. This thing converges to xm, whereas this one, by definition, there is some.
Power is just conjugation, right?
I didn't want to enter into details, but. I just try to express the fact that. The image of gamma by gamma k of this equivalence class converges to this. So you have a condition on the first coordinate, which is this one, and on the second coordinate, it means that in C, this thing converges to the identity. And what is this thing? It's exactly the image by rho of mk, ak, nk, which is mk, ak modulo m0.
This is not gamma k.
It's a
power,
it's a j.
It
looks like a gamma, but
this one is a j.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
For some integer.
Ah, thanks.
Okay, sorry.
No, don't worry.
No, gamma k is a. Ah, j. Oh, wait. And, okay. I will write this differently. This can be written that as xa0 m0 is equal to gamma 0 x. Okay, and then this thing is essentially gamma k, gamma zero to the power gk, x, nk. And so it exactly proves that the n orbit of x converges to xn. Okay, I cheated a little bit in the computation, but it's not very, okay, one can repair it. And I cheated more in the proof. Okay, there is something in the proof which works only in dimension d equals 3. So maybe you can, okay, if you think to it, you can see what is the problem in the higher dimension in this proof. One can modify it. Okay, time is going very, very fast, but I will still try to do other proofs. I will try to deduce from it the mixing.
Thank you.
Suppose that it's not mixing. Then you can find open sets O1 and O2 and a sequence TK going to infinity such that O1 ATK never intersect O2. Okay? You have your first open set here and your second open set here. Okay? But then we know at the level of the unit tangent bundle that there are periodic orbits of the geodesic flow are dense. And so if you lift it in the frame bundle, you can find a periodic orbit here. So there is some frame over a periodic orbit here in O2. And then what? As before, you know that modulo gamma, there is some E0, M0, such that that's the periodicity. And then I will... A0 is L0, L0 being the period. And then I will write TK as L0 GK plus SK. And I can assume that SK converges to some S infinity in 0 L0. And I also can assume that as M is a compact group, I can assume that M0 to the power GK converges to some M infinity. Okay, and in fact, to simplify the computation, just because I have no time, I will assume that S infinity is equal to 0 and M infinity is equal to E, but it's just to go faster. And then I know by the preceding result that the N orbit of X is dense. Okay? It's dense, so it's going to O1. So here I can find a W in Xn such that, but also in O1. And then, okay, it's in Xn, so it's in the strong stable manifold. So after some time it will be here. And so you get a contradiction. So this distance goes to zero, asymptotically they become closed, and as I assumed S infinity and M infinity to be trivial, these periodically will periodically converge to X up to a subsequence. And this will give you a contradiction with this property. That's the proof of mixing, and then I have still 3 minutes left. That's a short proof. Okay, it was a little bit fast, but it's really the idea without cheating. And I would like to prove. I will skip the third result, and I will concentrate on the fourth result because it's really an idea which will be useful to François. Again? Can you repeat, please?
You're using periodic orbits are dense in D here? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, periodic orbits of the geodesic flow are dense in the set omega, in the projection of omega in the unit tangent bundle.
You're using the geodesic, you have mixing there. Okay.
So I will prove. So it's a 4' proof that the U action, for the moment I only described properties of the N action, and now I want to go to U. Okay? I will prove that the U action on omega is topologically transitive. Meaning that for all open set O1 and O2, the U inside omega, the U orbit of O1 will intersect O2. And in fact, you can go from this property to the property on E thanks to the property 3. Okay? There is a game between omega and E, but okay. I will prove this, which is the key property. And then, how do I do that? First, we know that the action of A on omega is mixing. The mixing property is very robust. So it implies that the diagonal action of A times A on omega times omega is mixing. And mixing is a stronger property than transitivity. So it implies that it is topologically transitive. Topologically transitive means that there exists dense orbit. So there exist some frames x and y in omega times omega, such that if I push it by some element a in A, I will do it this in the past. Oh, it's on the right. X a minus one, minus n, y a minus one n is dense. This backward orbit is dense in omega times omega. That's a key point. But this thing does not really depend on x and y. There is an observation or exercise, which is that if this negative orbit x a minus 1, y a minus 1 is dense in omega square, then if I take any other frames x prime, y prime, with the same negative endpoint, okay, it's an asymptotic property in the past. So if I take any other frame, instead of x, I take another frame which has the same past as x, and any other frame than y which has the same past than y, then it's still true. What is still true? That this negative orbit is dense. Okay? Now I want to prove transitivity. Okay, I take, where is my property of transitivity? Ah, it's here. I want to prove this. Okay, so I will do it and then I finish the talk. Sorry. So I take my two open set, O1 and O2. Okay. I consider a couple XY satisfying this property. I have two frames, which in the past generate a dense A orbit. I have two frames, but then I will turn them. And I can turn them so that the and move them so that they become on the same U orbit, meaning that, okay, choose X prime and Y prime such that X prime U is equal to Y prime U. Why is it possible? Just see it on the picture. I said it depends only on the past. So I have a first frame, X, and I have another frame somewhere else. Why? Okay, first you move y plus to so that it comes here, but you don't change the past. Then you move it so that it becomes on the same strong stable manifold. And then you turn the both direction to align. Huh?
Align.
align the direction so that they become, you change X and Y, so that they become in the same circle. But you didn't, in fact, what you did, you considered geometrically on the boundary a circle which is going through X plus, X minus, and Y minus, Y minus. And on, viewed on the strong stable manifold, you can find two frames on the same U orbit. And so, okay. And then they have a backward dense orbit. So I have X prime and Y prime. They are on the same U orbit. And in the past, they are dense by mixing. So at some point, some of the iterate X prime A minus N is here in O1, whereas the Y prime A minus 1 is here. But by pushing backward by the A action, it does not change this property. And so they still are in the same U orbit. And then I let François explain you how to make this argument work with measures, which is more tricky. I'm sorry I'm late.